At the, like the first, if this was going to happen, all the PhD versions and all the talks was going to come up. So PHP 7 is here. How many of you have like heard about it? Good. Indeed. Okay. So about PHP versions, these are the versions that are like, these are the status of the versions. 5.4 secured fix only, 5.5 nearly dead, 5.6 currently like the stable version, 6 abandoned. So I'll get to that. I just brought this up because all of you guys were interested about the like the PHP kind of the release process. So the PHP release process is when something comes out, it will stay for 3 years, 2 years bug fixes, and a year of secured fixes only. So when a major version comes out, it's a backward incompatible thing. And major versions also like give new features and stuff. So if you want to do some backward compatible stuff with a minor version, you actually can't. So you need to wait till something, the major version comes up. This is the current thing. It was like noted down. So this is the expected one. So I guess you guys have there's like lots of discussion. So anybody knows like the process about how like stuff get done in PHP, So when you have something, either a new feature, unless it's like a bug fix, if it's a new feature or like some major problems or like a policy fix, you need to somebody puts an RFC. Request for comments, and then it gets discussed for 2 weeks, and then it goes into voting, and then it gets voted for like 2 weeks. So the whole voting process is also, there's an RFC for the voting process as well. You can go read it up. PHP voting members are like people who have like .NET php.net email addresses, I guess. There's like lots of details about it. This is not relevant to PHP 7 actually. What was I actually going to talk about today? PHP 7. So you guys are probably asking what happened to like PHP 6. There's like lots of rumors about it, like somebody deleted the branch or something. As usual, you have a RFC for that, saying why it should be named PHP 7 and not 6. Like people actually wrote books about PHP 6 before like it actually came out there. You have like nice things about evil book authors and stuff that goes around here. It got voted in. Most of the stuff like this like requires a two-third, like fifth, yeah.
Yeah, so what's the actual reasons for naming it PHP 7?
Because PHP 6 couldn't be like used. It was about like, it was an issue with Unicode stuff. They were trying to introduce Unicode and to all like functions.
Oh, so it's not just they named what was supposed to become PHP 6, they named it PHP 7, it just scrapped the whole thing.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, there was a project underway for PHP 7 that people are like working on, and that like didn't work out well. So all the stuff went into 5.5, I think. They backported everything like to be compatible. And there is like lots of details about it here. You can read it up. And you can read the PHP 6 book also, I guess, if you want. Yeah. So PHP 7 is out, like the RC1 is out. I think they'll keep on. So we'll like the number of RCs depends on like the stuff that comes up, the issues that comes up with the users and stuff. So please do test it out and like post comments on bugs or on the mailing list if there you have like problems. So I think it should be the stable version should be out in September, not September, October, right? According to the timeline. So there's an RFC for the timeline also, if you want to. Yeah. So major features, I think. So PHP 7 comes with Zend Engine 3. PHP 5 and stuff is like Zend Engine 2. It has a JIT compiling and abstract syntax tree. Previously, it was just parsing and then opcode. Now it's parsing, abstract syntax tree, and then opcodes. So you can do like optimizations on the trees and stuff. You also have like there's a good talk on this, on the difference between like Zend Engine 3 and like HHVM. And all the other like compilers by Anthony Ferrara. It's on YouTube. You can check it out. He goes into like much detail about like all the stuff in Lexing and all the stuff that you need to know about Zend Engine 3 and all the compilers. Yeah. So because of this, PHP is like supposed to be like really fast. 7 is really supposed to be really fast, and like being able to battle with like HHVM, which like almost binary, I guess, at some point. So that's good. I think I'm not sure. So this is the Zend Engine's benchmarking. So can see like there's a good performance between HHVM and PHP 7. It's definitely better than any other PHP version. But the new kid is HHVM. So yeah, that's there. There's lots of benchmarks going around. Like some shows HHVM up. It's all around the place. You know, like benchmarking.
I don't understand that graphic. What are the 6 bars? The first one is what? PHP 5.6.
Yeah.
5.6, 5.7, and 7, is it?
Yeah.
5.6.
And HHVM and 5.7.
Okay, and the left is the
exact,
the y, okay, request
person, okay. So there's like lots of, you can go around and there's lots of stuff about benchmarking. Yeah, so the other new very important feature, I think, like for PHP developers is like scalar type declarations. So type declarations, right? Probably people have like worked in like static languages like Java or stuff, because like PHP is dynamically typed for a very like it, from the beginning itself it was dynamically typed, and because of that like you had like a performance hit because of that, because you don't know like the types. And because you don't know the types, you cannot actually do some optimization on those. So because of that, you had like issues. This was a major issue. And in terms of like a mail threads going around like paper, it went up like 5 versions of the RFC to actually get one properly done. So it was not like done hastily, like people doing it. It was like being worked on for some time. So the one person actually quit contributing also because of this. And like you could, if you like go back and look at all the mailing lists, there was like lot of shouting around, lots of explicit stuff. Can imagine. So what they came up with is a dual system, being strict and like weak at the same time, and you have the ability to like change that. See my cursor. That's
Are the scalar type can they accept nulls? Because that was the big issue with type hinting, right? You put type hinting, but it can't accept null parameters, and it became useless.
That's also done. It can be int variable equals null. So if it's you don't get that type. It can be null.
So in this case, B, can I pass null to it?
Just give me a second.
I think that was one reason why type hinting never really took off, right? If you can't pass null to objects, types, then it becomes kind of
useful. It's mostly about like the being like dynamic, I guess, because PHP you can do like crazy stuff, but though we actually people say it's dynamic type, it's actually not dynamic type internally. It's all it just changes state. It says okay, this is a int now, this is a string now.
No, I get that, but my point is null has always been. Most other programming languages, null was still acceptable for scalar types as well, right? So the point is that when they're introducing scalar types, is null an acceptable value for that scalar variable?
If it's an int, I think.
Well, then there's a difference between null and zero.
Yeah, there is a difference
between
null and
zero. Yeah, so null is actually undefined, basically, when it comes down to, yeah. A null is undefined.
Okay, null should not be undefined. Undefined is when I've not declared it. Null is when I've declared it and I've set it to null. Mm. But
yeah, there is some issues, to say the least. There is some issues. That's the okay.
Does anybody use type hinting? Does it? How do you guys manage nulls?
Okay. So I'm guessing you're asking this. It's basically should be null, integer.
It doesn't work.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
To be honest, if you're setting it to be a specific type, passing it a wrong type should throw an error. Right? Now it's another type. You're passing the wrong type in, it should throw an error, which is correct behavior.
Yeah. Well, at least with type hinting, it was a bit more debatable because it's an object type, and null is a perfectly good object value, right?
But it's the wrong type. It's still the wrong type.
What are the scalar types that will be supported?
So it's int Boolean and
Java did have that restriction, but eventually they even took it out.
Okay.
And scalar values could have null values.
Okay. Is it documented somewhere? Scalar type is okay.
Yeah. So, it's int float string and bool. So there in a next version, there would be like other stuff as well. So currently you can type int objects, right? In PHP, you can say like give a class name and it would be like, because those are like, you can determine those. If something is not an object and you want an object, and if it doesn't give an object, you cannot really do anything with it. But the problem that they had was like, if we don't have to say int or anything, you don't have to say int or anything here. If we get like a string one even, if you do the like, if you want to work with it, you can actually work with it. If you want to, whereas like if it's an object or class or like some other thing, if you don't get it, you actually cannot do anything with the thing that you get, basically. So that was the issue with this stuff. So these are currently the stuff that are supported, but there isn't like a RFC for other types as well. I think, and they have like been reserved. Like, let's not. So yeah. So strict type is done using declare. It's a declarative that has been there before. It's been used for something called tick. I'm not sure whether you use it. It was previously there, and say it tick, and then number of times that the function you want calls up, it will invoke this, basically. So when you say strict underscore type equals one, basically the strictness type hinting is only occurs to this file, and everything that's called from this file. So yeah. So when you call like file two with this thing on, even if this file does not have the declare, this should be like strictly checked. And if you declare here and let's try it, I guess. It works good because of this. Even if you remove that, it works. It works. So if you, this is the test. Even if you, because I like not strict hinted this file, so there is no strictness, it's fake. Yeah, these things like happens like file per file basis only. If you're like inheriting from something and it has already a type declared, the inherited stuff should also like abide by that. And if it's not the inherited the parent class or something has not like declared all the type ints, then you can declare your own things, and it happens down the chain, like interface implements. If there is abstract class, so it happens down the chain. Anywhere down the chain, if it's not like previously defined, you can define it. That's that.
So in a framework, if I put there in the bootstrap, everything straight.
Yeah. So everything that's called from that file is strictly checked. Yeah. So it's only for file per file basis. So the other thing is return types. So return types are like declared like this. Not your kind of fancy Java or C++, C kind of return me. But this is if you have like worked with hack, this is it's the same thing that they do. So basically this is a float, and that's why that error is. So it the same thing happens for return types as well. It's file per file basis, and it also happens down the chain. The same old things that happens to like type declarations as well. These are some other stuff. Null coalescence, it's if you work with JavaScript, you can say something pipe something pipe something, and if you go down the variables, and if something is not null, it will assign it. It's something like this. When this is not declared, this is null, and because this is there, it will like equate it, and so you'll see 2 instead of end. Spaceship operator. It's a combined 3-way operator, which is so if it's equal, it's 0. If the left is greater, it's -1. If the right is greater, it's +1. So that happens to objects as well. There is some issue with some other stuff, but it actually should only like give only 0, -1, or +1. But there like we found some instances where it gave like 3 or something. So it's less or greater than or equal to or something.
Used for creating sort. You use that to create sorting algorithms.
Yeah. Constant array. Div is integer division. You'll get a whole number. Closure, there is a now new method. Previously you had to bind to, and it was only like compile time bindings, and now during runtime you can bind to something and then run it. Anonymous classes. Basically, you can like send something with like no name. It's called the default name is class anonymous. So if you want to, it's only should be done like if you like just want to throw in a class and then get it over with. You don't want to reuse it or something. Group use. Okay. Yeah. So this is that's basically that. You can like combine everything and then use it. That's that. The name says it all, I guess. Then there is context sensitive lex. That's okay. So if you can see this example, you know, like include is a global function, but because this include is in like a class. Because of that, you can actually use it as a method as well. So this gives the possibility, because PHP has like 67 reserved variables, like names, and because of that, these but still these also can be used depending on the context. throwable and errors. Okay. So throwable. So. So PHP, you know about exceptions, right? There is exceptions, and then you have fatal errors. So previously, fatal errors couldn't catch them, like they go off and like you need to trace the logs or something to find it. So in the new thing, all fatal errors are catchable, and it will go through the final as well, nothing beyond that. So difference between exceptions and errors, I think like there is something that's a thing that's going on as well. So what happens is there is a throwable interface that both of these things actually inherit from. The throwable interface is internal only and cannot be implemented. You can implement your own exception or error. So errors can be like pinged as like runtime errors or something. Exceptions are like your problems, and errors are like PHP's problems, sort of. Unicode code points. So now you can do your Unicode stuff in double strings, and it will be proper Unicode and not be a string or something. Like you can see the difference between those two.
3 minutes. Okay.
So these are some changes. Those are previous ones were features. These are changes. Previously, you could actually put multiple breaks on switches. Now it's only one. Reverse reserve mode types. Some more types that have been reserved. You cannot use it for class names. and some other stuff, interfaces and stuff, normally. Then real octals. So previously octals, when it like saw octal, it would like go through, and as soon as it's not an octal, it will like leave that, and that's the octal. Now from now on, everything should be like real octal. List improvements. That's a whole. There's like a subset of stuff. Now it will not do strings. You need to do string splits or something. List doesn't do that. This is cryptographically secure pseudo random number generation or something. Yeah. So what it will do is like pseudo random numbers using your like different mediums basically. It will depend on like dev random, or like there's like five options that it has. It will take one of them and give it out. Password underscore hash, there is an option called salt for that. It was removed, and now it uses like the default salt that it produces. So there is actually quite a lot more. So this is the migration docs we have created. So it has all the changes that has gone in, and there'll be like more changes that will be coming up as well. So yeah, that's it. This was TLDR, okay.
Right. So you have any questions for Prasindhu? You can ask him later. He's one of those guys that has a php.net email address, so yeah. You know, it's kind of cool.
Yeah, they just give it to you. It's okay.